always been faithful to me.
Hello, hello, and happy new year, and welcome to Faith and Knitting. Thank you so much for joining me. If you're new here, my name is Rhonda, and I live just outside of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, with my family. And I'm so grateful that you've joined me. This has been such a great adventure doing this podcast. And I want to say thank you, first of all, so much to all of you who are watching, to those of you who've been subscribing and sharing the channel and recommending it to others. I am so thankful to you. It's amazing and it's wonderful how the channel is growing and people are watching, and it's just been such a blessing. I am so honored and privileged. It's been wonderful. Thank you so much. I am so grateful. I want to say again, Happy New Year. I hope you're off to a good start. I hope your year is off to a good start. I hope that you're finding time to rest and relax, that you're making goals and plans for the new year. That's one thing I always enjoy doing at the beginning of the new year, and getting that fresh, clean calendar and just filling it in with plans and goals and ideas and thoughts and prayers about what I would like to see happen in the new year, and, you know, just dreaming about what God might have also for me in the new year. So I hope that you're excited about this new year. And once again, I hope it's off to a good start for you. So the night before last, we got a little bit of snow. It's not as much as they were thinking, I think, but we got about 4 inches of snow. And it was just enough to cover the ground and make everything beautiful and white and clean. I love the look of it outside. And then yesterday it was very sunny, so a lot of it is melted already. But there's still a lot of white out there, and enough to make it very bright in here, which is very, very nice. I always enjoy the snow when everything is covered and it looks just so pure and clean and white. And I hope you had a lovely Christmas time with your family, with friends. We had a wonderful time here. It was just a quiet, peaceful Christmas. It was just me, my husband, and our 3 children, our 2 sons and our daughter. Our daughter came home from her college in Boston, and it was so good seeing her. It was good having her home here. We enjoyed the time together, and then she was home for about 3 weeks, and last Sunday, tomorrow will be a week, she left for her semester in London. So Boston wasn't far enough. She's in London now. She's going to be spending the spring semester abroad doing studies over there. She'll be back at middle of April, I think. So yeah, I'm happy for her. It's a wonderful opportunity. She was very excited. And at one point we weren't sure if it was going to actually happen because of COVID and the cases were increasing over there. And it looked like things may be shutting down in England or in London. So we weren't sure how it was going to work, but they went ahead with it. She's over there. So we're praying for her. We're, you know, keeping her in our prayers. And so far she's enjoying it. She's made a few friends, and she's been able to go out on tours. And so yeah, it's good. It's good. Yeah, it's good. So hopefully we might get a chance to go and visit her either at the end of March or at the beginning of April, near the end of her term over there. So we'll see how that goes, if that works out. But you know, it's good. I hope that you are doing well also. And I know that this may be seen as a Christian channel or a channel for Christians, but I just want to say that everyone is welcome here. I enjoy sharing my faith. I enjoy sharing my knitting and my crafts with everyone. So it's not just for people who know God. It's not just for people who consider themselves Christian. All people, anyone, everyone is welcome here. So I just wanted to say that. And if you may be someone who's not a Christian, but you're considering or you want to know more about faith or about God, then this is a great channel for you. And you may be a person who's never considered faith in God. You never gave it a thought. And this is a great channel for you also, because I want to use the time here to introduce people to God who don't know God, or those of you who do know God. It's a chance for you to just be reminded of his goodness and of his grace and his mercy. So whether you know God or you don't, whether you consider yourself a Christian or not, you are welcome here. I am glad you're here. Welcome. So what I would like to talk about today, and if you're new here, I always start out with a devotional thought. And what I'd like to talk about today, the title I gave it is Everyday Joy. It's a way of how can we have joy every day. Joy is mentioned in the Bible at least 242 times that I could tell. And as believers, I think that joy is supposed to be a big part of our lives. I found so many scriptures about joy. I'm going to share, probably I have too many, but I'd like to share a few of them with you. Just to show you what God says to us about joy and about having joy. So the first one I'd like to share with you is Psalm 5, verse 11. And it says, "But let all who take refuge in you be glad. Let them ever sing for joy. Spread your protection over them, that those who love your name may rejoice in you." So those who love God's name may rejoice in him. And it says, let all who take refuge in you be glad. So when we take our refuge in God, when he's that place that we go to, that we rely on, that we trust in, we can find gladness. Psalm 28:7 says, "The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him and he helps me. My heart leaps for joy and with my song, I praise him." Job 33:26. "Then that person can pray to God and find favor with him. They will see God's face and shout for joy. He will restore them to full well-being." That is a promise that we find in God's word. They will see God's face and shout for joy. Psalm 66:1 says, "Shout for joy to God, all the earth." And that is a command. That is something that we are told to do. Shout for joy to God. And who should shout? All the earth, all of us, shout for joy to God. Psalm 71:23, "My lips will shout for joy when I sing praise to you, I whom you have delivered." My lips will shout for joy when I sing praise to you, because God, you have delivered me. That's Psalm 71:23. Psalm 81:1, "Sing for joy to God, our strength. Shout aloud to the God of Jacob." I love that because it's not something quiet or, you know, kind of muted or toned down. This is singing for joy, shouting aloud. And these are commands. Shout for joy to God, our strength. Shout aloud to the God of Jacob. And I probably, again, have too many scriptures. So I'm going to see if I include all of them. I don't want to just like wear you out with scriptures, but I do want to just show you God's thoughts on our joy. Psalm 90:14, "Satisfy us in the morning with your unfailing love, that we may sing for joy and be glad all our days." Psalm 98:4, "Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music." We are told to shout for joy, sing for joy, leap for joy. And again, this is not a weak, half-hearted, just barely there kind of joy. This is bursting into jubilant song type of joy. So this is what God is asking for us. This is what God wants for us and from us. This kind of heart-pounding, jubilant, exultant joy. And there's a couple more scriptures. I'm sorry. I know I tend to go overboard with the scriptures because I enjoy them so much. I really like them. So, and this is one of my favorites. 1 Peter 1:8 says, "Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. I love that. Though you haven't seen him, you love him. And none of us here, none of us alive today, have really seen him, but we love him. And even though we don't see him now, we believe in him. And because of that belief, he says, you are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. This is big time joy. And another one that's so good is Jude 1:24. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling. And he's talking about God here. He says, to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy. So God is able to keep us from stumbling. There's a lot of things that we can stumble over in life, but he says God is able to keep you from stumbling and present you before his glorious presence, bring you to himself without fault, without a stain, without a blemish on you, and with great joy. God is able to do that. And now, one of the most famous ones that we might have just heard recently last month during Christmas time, Luke chapter 2, verse 10 says, but the angel said to them, do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. And this news, of course, was the birth of Christ. But he says this news is good news, first of all, and this news will cause great joy for all the people. The birth of Christ is a cause for great joy, not just for some, but for all the people. And another one that is very meaningful is John chapter 17, verse 13. And this is Jesus praying just before he went to the cross, praying with his disciples, talking to God about his disciples. And it says in John chapter 17, verse 13, he says, I am coming to you now, but I say these things while I am still in the world, so that they may have the full measure of my joy within them. So that they may have the full measure of my joy within them. Jesus prayed about our joy. That's how important it is. He prayed about it. He spoke to God about it. We are meant to be people of joy. And so the thing is, it doesn't always characterize us. We can be prone to be stressed and overworked. We can be prone to complaining and crankiness because life is tough. There are so many things that we have going on. There's so many things to do. There's problems and issues and difficulties that we have to deal with. So sometimes our joy can get lost. It can be hard to find joy, especially everyday joy. It doesn't seem to come naturally to us. In fact, I don't think it does come naturally to us. So it can be a problem to have everyday joy, to maintain that joy every day. I want to go back to what I said before, that Jesus prayed for our joy. And this was his high priestly prayer, what they call his high priestly prayer from John chapter 17. And he is our high priest. And the high priest interceded for the people to God. He was just about to leave his disciples and go back to heaven. And as our high priest, he interceded for us on our behalf to the Father in heaven. He prayed for us. He prayed for our joy to be full. But why did he do that? Why would he pray for our joy? He could have prayed for our health, for our financial security. He could have prayed for our comfort, for us to have no problems, for our struggles to cease. He could have prayed for so many things for us. But he prayed that our joy might be full. And not even just that we would have joy, but that it would be full joy, like the full measure of my joy within them is what he said, like total, complete joy. So why is that so important? But first, the fact that Jesus prayed for it. Don't you think God heard that prayer? And don't you think God answered that prayer? So God has provided a way for us to have joy, even everyday joy, no matter what our circumstances are. But first, I want to talk about why it's so important, and then I want to talk about how we can have that joy. So why is it so important? Why is it so important that one of the last things on Jesus' mind before he left his disciples was their joy? Why is that so important? And maybe it's important because it's one of the things that makes us stand out as Christians, as followers of Christ. There's so little joy found in the world. And I don't even think the world can actually give us real, true joy. And like love, we are to be recognized and characterized by our joy. Our joy should make others look at us and say to themselves, how can they do that? How can they be going through this difficult situation that they're going through and still be so full of joy? How can they have still such a peaceful, hopeful attitude? Whatever it is that they have, I want. That's what our joy should be bringing about in people. That's what people should be thinking as they look at us and see the joy that we have. That's how we can be a witness for Christ. We can show the world something that they can't get anywhere else. In that high priestly prayer from John chapter 17, the Lord said to the Father, "As you sent me into the world, I am sending them into the world." Jesus came into the world. Well, one of the reasons he came into the world was to reveal the Father to us, to show us what the Father is like. And even at one point he said, "If you've seen me, you've seen the Father." He is the exact representation of the Father. So he could say that. And now I believe he sends us out so that we can reveal what he is like to the world, so the world may know what he is like. Just as he came to reveal what the Father is like, so he sends us out to the world to reveal what he is like. He said, "As you have sent me, so I am sending them." So in theory, we should be able to say, if you've seen me, you've seen Jesus. Now, I don't know anybody who could say that, really, honestly. That is a very tall mountain to climb. But that's why we've been given the Holy Spirit, who works in us. And his job is to make us more and more like Jesus by increasing the fruit of the Spirit in us so that we can have more love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, faithfulness, all the fruit of the Spirit. He is working that in us so that we can show Christ to the world and that they can come to know him as well. The Bible actually talks about us being joyful in tribulation, maintaining our joy in the midst of struggles and trials and suffering, and even looking at those things as a cause for joy. So how could we ever do that without the Spirit of God working in us to be able to look at our struggles as a cause for joy, because we see them as something that God is using to work something in us? There's a friend of mine that he and his wife just had a really, really tragic event happen in their lives. I won't go into specifics about it because I didn't ask him about sharing this, but just as an example, he and his wife had this really sad, tragic event. And we were with him not long ago. We were asking him, there was a group of us, and we were asking him, you know, how things are going, how are you guys doing? And he told us, you know, it's still hard. It's still, some days are better than other days, but it's still it's difficult, but you know, they're trusting God and they're making it. But he did tell us that, he said that there's a couple of people at work that he works with who have mentioned to him, you know, "I don't know how you're going through this thing. and you're still peaceful, you're still calm, you don't seem, actually devastated. And they were asking him, how are you able to do that? How are you still so strong in the face of this? And he talked, he shared with them about his faith in God, and he believes that God is working things out and that God is going to bring a good outcome out of this tragedy. And they actually said, well, I would like to know more about that. And he told us that he's actually going to be starting, he and his wife are going to be starting a Bible study with a couple of people from his office because of them seeing how they have gone through this terrible event, this terrible tragedy. And that's what I'm talking about. Our joy, our peace in the midst of a storm can be a witness to those around us when they see us trusting God, steady, maintaining a calmness, maintaining a peacefulness in the midst of a bad situation. It speaks to people. People notice that. And that is how we can be a witness for God. But how is our joy made complete? How are we able to have that type of fullness of joy? And I think the Bible gives us the answer to all of life's questions if we would just take the time to look for them. We tend to look to ourselves first to provide to provide for our own needs. We have a natural instinct for self-preservation. So we look to ourselves because we want to fix it. We can do it. We're going to take care of it. And then if that doesn't work, after we've worn ourselves out trying to fix it and it hasn't worked, then we go to others. We look to others for answers and solutions that can help us. But if we would remember that God has promised to meet our needs, it would save us a lot of time and trouble. Our joy is connected to God. He fills our hearts with joy. In His presence is fullness of joy. As we spend time with Him in His presence, He works His joy in us. And I have a couple of scriptures, again, to show that. Psalm 21:6 says, surely you have granted him unending blessings and made him glad with the joy of your presence. Psalm 16:11. You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasure at your right hand. That is joy. You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasure at your right hand. This is talking about us in the presence of God and being filled with joy. You fill me with joy in your presence. When we take that time to get with Him, to focus on Him, He then is able to fill us with joy when we spend time in His presence. Another way that the Bible shows that God gives us joy is that He provides for us. He cares for our needs as we put our trust in Him so that we can have the joy of assurance that things are good, that we are okay. Deuteronomy 16:15 says, the end of that verse says, for the Lord your God will bless you in all your harvest and in all the work of your hands, and your joy will be complete. That's that complete joy again. And then in Psalm 126:3, the Lord has done great things for us. We are filled with joy. Full joy because of what God has done for us. Acts 14:17, the end of that verse says, He has shown kindness by giving you rain from heaven and crops in their seasons. He provides you with plenty of food and fills your hearts with joy. God takes care of us. Because He takes care of us now, we can know, and because God doesn't change, we can know that He will take care of us in the future. He will take care of us always. So that fills our hearts with joy, just to have that certainty. Another thing to consider about joy is that it's a matter of our focus. Where we place our attention. If we choose to focus on what is wrong, we choose to focus on what we don't have, we will most likely not have joy. But if we choose to focus on God and what He has promised and what He has done and what He can do, our perspective changes. Psalm 118:24 says, "This is the day the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it." Now, if you look closely at that psalm, it doesn't sound like things are going really that great. It's almost like he's saying, this is what it is. This is what I got. I'm going to choose to rejoice and be glad. This is the day the Lord has made for me. If it's difficult, if it's hard, even if it's painful, I'm going to still trust Him. I'm going to believe that He knows what He's doing, and I'm going to believe that He can bring good out of it. So I am going to rejoice. It sounds like he's making a decision. Our perspective has a lot to do with our attitude. So choose joy. Choose to focus on God and on His goodness rather than on the problem. So one last thought on joy. Once when I was teaching about joy to the women at the prison, one of the women said to me, or she reminded me of this acronym, J-O-Y. And she said, it stands for Jesus, Others, You. And I said, oh yeah, I've seen that before. And that it's really a good one, because that should be the order. God first, then others, and then ourselves. And even the Lord, once when someone asked him, you know, what are the greatest commandments? What are the most important things that we should be doing? And he said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength, and with all your soul. Love your neighbor as yourself. And so that's the order. Love God, love your neighbor, that's others, as you love yourself, that's you. So God, others, you. And we kind of tend to get it backwards. We kind of tend to be, we put the Y first, which stands for ourselves, then others, and then God. Like I mentioned before, we tend to put ourselves first. We kind of try to fix everything. We focus on ourselves and our problems, and we want to fix it. And then when that doesn't work, we go to others. And we try others, and we see what they can say and what they can do. And that's a normal thing. Self-centeredness and self-focused thinking does not produce joy. It does not produce joy. It doesn't mean that we don't do anything for ourselves, or that we don't take care of ourselves, or that we ignore our own needs. We're still on the list. We are to do those things. We're still on the list. It's J-O-Y, Jesus, others, you. So we are still on the list. We're just no longer at the top of the list. It's just been, we're going to flip it, and we're no longer at the top of the list. And when we get that order right, Jesus, others, you, J-O-Y, it does produce joy in our lives. So again, choose joy. Practice joy. Spend time with God in His presence. Ask Him to fill you with His joy. Allow Him to fill you with His joy so that you can show the world something that they don't have. And when they ask you about it, be ready to give a reason for the hope that you have. That is why we're here. The idea of a light shining in the darkness has really stuck with me. I used the image of a single candle burning in the darkness at the end of the Christmas episode with the caption, "The light shines in the darkness." And I used the same image on my Instagram page for my New Year's greeting. I had the image of the candle shining in the darkness, and I wrote, "Continue to let your light shine in 2022. And that's really what I'd like to see more and more. Those of us who follow Christ, to let our light shine in a dark world. Again, that is why we're here. So I hope this has encouraged you. Let your light shine. Choose joy. Show Him to the world. So as we move into the knitting portion of the episode, I'll talk about what I'm wearing. Maybe you've noticed this is the sweater that I made. I talked about it, I think, in episode 1 and 2, maybe. I call it the pandemic sweater, my pandemic sweater, because I wanted to have a sweater. It was during the early part of the lockdown, and I didn't have enough yarn to make a sweater. And so I just put together lots of different yarns that I kind of went together, and I made what I call the pandemic sweater because the yarn stores were all closed. Everything was closed. It was locked down. So I'll show you. It's a little big. I'll show you. But I like it. It kind of feels a little bit like Joseph in the coat of many colors. but it's warm. And it's not one that I wear out a lot because I'm not sure of it. But I like it. It's very warm. I wear it around the house mostly. It's really a combination of, I guess, about 5 or 6 different yarns. And it was a pattern that I used. I'll try to get a picture of it. It was from Barocco. It was one of their old patterns. There are a few problems with it. This still seems not to want to lie flat. It was knit long ways. We knit it this way. And then I had to pick up stitches around the collar and do the collar band and on down to the front. And that was something that I had not done before. And it's a little wonky. You know, there's some little areas here that are not great, but it was the first time and I think it serves the purpose. It's warm. I enjoy wearing it. It's very colorful, so it goes with lots of things. I like to wear it with gray. And so that is the pandemic sweater that I made early pandemic last year. So the next object I'd like to share with you is the Purl Soho half and half triangles wrap. And of course, I'm keeping it in my little project bag, which I'm still so happy with. This is the progress. And this again is going to be a long-term project. I'm thinking that I'll probably be going with this until about at least March, maybe April, I'm not sure. But I'll put a picture of it up. And this is the length that I have so far with it. So it's growing and I've used one ball so far. I'm on the second ball right now. And I don't know, I guess it's about 8 inches now. And that is that. And I'm using the Purl Soho linen quill. So this is the color that I'm using now, that I'm working with now. And this is the second color because it's a two color shawl. This one is called, and of course it's linen quill. It's Purl Soho linen quill. It is 50% fine Highland wool and 35% alpaca and 15% linen. So it has a very nice softness to it. It's very easy to work with. And this color is called True Turquoise. And the lighter color is called Celadon. It's two colors, two contrasting colors or two complementary colors, however you want to do it. And there are two large triangles put together to make a rectangle. And so there's so many different ways you can wear it. If you go to Ravelry and look on there, and just look up Purl Soho half and half triangles wrap, you can see tons of different ones that people have made in all kinds of colors. And it's just such a beautiful, fun knit. And it's really easy. It's all garter stitch. And so it's going to be a long-term project. And I'll be showing you as it's progressing. Right now, I think I'm about at 8 inches. And so I'll just keep going with it. It should be taking me till probably March, at least March, I think, to finish it. The needles I'm using on this is, and I've talked about that, I had a little problem with the thin needles. These are size 4 that I'm doing this on. And I think the pattern calls for either size 3 or size 4. So I'm using the size 4 needles. And I've always, in the past, worked with larger yarn and larger needles. So this has been something that I needed to get used to, these small little needles. But I think I'm getting better with it. It's getting more comfortable. It's feeling a little bit more natural to working with this smaller size needles. And there are a few little places that I dropped the stitches and I wasn't able to get them back on correctly. So there's a couple of little places that are a little like, but overall, I'm very happy with it. I'm looking forward to continuing and starting the second color maybe soon. I'm not sure. Maybe still a few weeks off for the second color, but I think it's going to be beautiful. I'm really looking forward to wearing it and enjoying it in the spring, because I think these colors will be really nice for springtime. So that's the Purl Soho half and half triangles wrap. The next project I'd like to share with you are my socks. And and this is the first time I've made socks. These are the socks. Bring this over. And this might be hard to see because of my multicolored sweater that I'm wearing, but here they are. This is where I am so far. And this pattern is the Paintbox Essential Socks. This is the pattern that I'm using, the Essential Socks by Paintbox. And I'm actually making them a little bit higher up on the leg because I like my socks a little bit higher than that. So I'm attempting to make them a little bit higher. Well, that should be no problem. I'll just go a little longer with it. But here they are on these little needles. And this is, I think these are size 3 needles that I'm using for this. Again, those small needles, man. But it's coming along. I'm getting used to it. And I think it looks good. It seems like it's a little big, though. I don't know if I hold it this way, it looks a little wide. I tried it on. It seems to fit. It stays up on the leg. It doesn't, you know, droop down. So I'm going to continue with it and see how it goes. I think I have another maybe 2 inches before I start the heel. And that's going to be the tricky part, I think, because that seems to be the most difficult part of the sock is the heel. But I got some good advice from one of my lovely viewers, Ellen, at Earthwise Emporium. She suggested that I watch sock tutorials by Denise from Earth Tones Girl. And she said that she has great sock tutorials. And I had heard of her, but I haven't watched any of her videos or her tutorials. So I'm going to go there and just check it out and just get some advice and some help with my sock heels when I get to the heel part. And probably the toe would also be another part that might be a little tricky. But I like the yarn. The yarn that I'm using is by West Yorkshire Spinners. It's their signature 4-ply. There's the label. And the purple color, which you can just see, I just did the cuff in purple, and I'm gonna try to have the heel and the toe also in this purple color, which looks really good with the rest of, with the stripey color. I wasn't sure because it's not the same purple that's in the stripe, but I think it blends really nicely with them, and it'll be a nice contrast to have the cuff, the heel, and the toe in this purple. And the purple is called Penny Royale. I'll show you. It's just a nice, soft, a little bit heathery purple. Really pretty. And the striped is also by Yorkshire Spinners. And this color is called Passionfruit Cooler. And so this is 75% wool, 25% nylon. Again, signature 4-ply. It's also easy to work with. It feels very soft. It doesn't feel scratchy at all. But once, you know, it's complete and I try it on, I'll have to see. And what I did was I saw that some people, as they're knitting their socks, because they have that second sock syndrome that you hear about a lot. You finish one sock and then somehow you just don't have the wherewithal to start the second sock. So the second sock never gets finished. But I saw that some people were kind of doing simultaneously, not on the same, you know, if you do the, what is it called? Magic loop, you can do 2 socks at once. But I'm doing it with the double pointed needles. So what they do is they do one part on the first sock, and then they do that part on the second sock. And then they do the second part on the first sock, and then they go to the second sock. So you kind of go back and forth between the socks. And So I'm trying to do that. Here's my, on these little tiny needles, it looks like little baby needles. This is the cuff for the second sock. And now I'm ready to, I'm at the point where I would start in with the self-striping yarn. So I have to, I don't know, I guess I'll get to the heel part of this and then I'll go back to this and do, I don't know, is it called the shank? The part that goes on the leg. So I'm trying to do this simultaneous sock knitting just so that once you're finished, then you're finished. You don't have to go back and start over from scratch, because I think that would be kind of hard mentally just to be finished, excited about a finished product, and then the idea that now I have to go back and redo it again for the second one. So I think this should help me as well to do it kind of simultaneously. So that is the sock. I'm enjoying it. I don't know what else I want to say about it. They are on size 3 needles, I think this is. And I just know, one thing I know, I have learned, I have discovered, is that I don't want to knit with anything smaller than a 3. Actually, these are size 2 needles. These are size 2 needles. So, I just said I don't want to knit with anything smaller than a 3. But I guess I don't want to knit with anything smaller than a 2, because these small needles are really troublesome sometimes. So these are my my essential socks that I will continue on, and again, simultaneous knitting. And I'm enjoying it though. I'm looking forward to wearing them. Hopefully they'll fit. They won't be too big, but we'll have to wait and see on that one. Enjoying my socks. And this next project, I'm really excited about sharing it with you. It is the Sabela sweater by Isabell Kraemer. And as I talked about this pattern, I think in episode 8, I shared about it. And she is one of those designers that just everything that she designs just really resonates with me. Just her style, her aesthetic, I just enjoy every pattern that she comes out with, I want to make. And I've never made one of her patterns before, but when I saw this sweater, I said, okay, this is the time. I'm gonna get the pattern. I'm gonna make this sweater. It's called the Sabela sweater. And again, it's by Isabell Kraemer. I'll put a picture up on the screen so you can see. Actually, let me show you. I have it here. Because our printer only does black and white, so I'm going to show you, if you can see this, if it's not too much of a glare, that's Isabell Kraemer. She's modeling her sweater, and that's the Sabela. Sorry about the glare on it. It's a striped sweater, and she did this thing with the two little, with the contrasting sleeve. Just the last few stripes on the sleeve were a contrasting color. And I thought that is so cool. So that's her in her sweater. And they actually show, because the red is not really my color. I'm going to actually make my sweater. The contrasting color, the blue and the gray that she uses on the sleeve, that's going to be the color sweater that I'm going to make. And they have it here. This is on Ravelry. You can find the pattern. And they have lots of different types of lots of different sweaters that people have made from this pattern. And this is one that someone made, and those are the colors that I'm going to use, this blue and gray. Cause that's just really my colors that I enjoy so much. So I've just started it. I've just cast it on a few days ago. I've only done a little bit of work on it so far. This is what I have so far. So it's just the beginning, and it's, starts with the neckline and it goes down, but you can see I've just started the color, so this is the neckline, so it will be held this way. And I started the first blue stripe, and it is done with Myak yarns, and it is Kupa. There it is, Kupa. And this is the blue that I'm using. It's kind of a beautiful heathery blue with a little bit of gray in it. Very soft. The yarn is, let's see, 50% baby yak and 50% organic cotton. And this color is Diti, D-I-T-I. This is the blue that I'm using. Really, really pretty. And the, let's see, this one. And this one, the cream, it's sort of a cream when you look at it just by itself. But I think when you put it next to the blue, it starts to look a little gray. So I'm calling it gray. And the color of this is also the Myak Kupa. And this color is Samana. It's called Samana. And so this is the Samana in the Myak Kupa. Again, 50% yak, 50% organic cotton. Really soft, really easy to work with. It is that little thin yarn, but I guess I'll have to get used to fingering weight yarn. That's just all there is to it. There's a lot of patterns that call for it, and you gotta try new things. You gotta keep going. And this is the contrasting color. I think I'm gonna do the sleeve the way she shows it in her, the last few stripes on the sleeve, I think I'm gonna do in this color. And this one, I have it stuck down in here. This is called Mithra. It's also the Myak Kupa. It's called Mithra. So I'm going to do the little contrasting sleeve in the red. I'll have the, let me get back to her picture. I'll have the blue and gray stripes and then the red on the contrast for the sleeve. And I think that's gonna just be really, really beautiful. And this one I am doing, I think these are, let me just check. I think these are size 4. Yes, these are size 4 needles. And size 4 is pretty good. Let's see. Size 4 is, it's like borderline, I think. This feels very comfortable. And so it's coming along. I'm looking so forward to getting a little bit more, being able to see the stripes together. I think it's going to be so nice. And I hope, you know, the fit is going to be good. There are certain things with it. I've gotten a little hole already right there. And I was tried to figure out why and what went wrong. And I wanted, thought about, well, maybe I'll just rip it back and go and fix it. But I don't think I'm going to do that. You know, I just have to live with imperfection. I'm not perfect. The sweaters and the things that I knit are not going to be perfect. So to drive myself crazy for every little thing, but I'm just thinking this might be right like here, like right in the front of this, right in the front of the sweater. So I don't know. I just like, you know, live dangerously, I guess. So I'm going to keep going, and maybe at the end I can kind of pull these two yarns together a little bit and pinch that hole closed. I'll see. But again, this little thin yarn does give me problems sometimes. But I'm looking forward to this. And I actually was thinking and wanting to enter this in the Unity Cal. Cedar Hill Yarns started a Unity Cal at the beginning of this year, just 7 days ago. And I thought, oh, I'll enter my Sabela sweater because I hadn't cast it on yet. And now I haven't entered, I didn't go and do the, whatever the things are that you need to enter, I haven't done. And I still want to enter it. I've, you know, because I think it's okay. It's, I cast it on at the right time. I just didn't do what I needed to do to enter the cowl. Because I like the idea of a unity cowl, bringing things together, bringing people together, and just gathering around the art of knitting. And there should be harmony, there should be peace, and there should be, you know, just camaraderie-ship, if that's a word. It's nice to have that sense of unity. I think that's really important. So when I read about the cowl, when I first heard about it, I thought, oh, I want to join that. And I still want to, and I still plan to, and I'm going to enter this as my project. Because unity is important. You know, it's so good to have this community, this knitting community. Like I mentioned that Ellen at Earthwise Emporium gave me advice about where to look to find help with my sock knitting, about checking out Earth Tones Girl for sock tutorials. And then someone else wrote, gave me advice about the socks, about it shouldn't be too thin. Like if you can see through the fabric that's created, then you might want to tighten it up a little bit because your socks won't last very long. They're going to wear out quickly. And there's just been so much good advice. People were giving me advice about the sweater that I had that it seemed like the yoke was too big. The sweater, actually the next thing I'm going to show you, where I think the yoke is a little bit too big. And so there were people writing in to say, well, you could try this or you could do that. You could, you know, pick up stitches around and bring it in a little bit. So that's the community that I enjoy so much with knitting. And so I think this Unity Cal would be a great thing. I'm going to try to go ahead and enter that and just have something that brings us together. There's so much that divides us in the world. And I just to have this Cal, this knit along that we can share our projects. We can share our struggles with our projects. We can share advice and encouragement. I think it's so important. So I'm glad to be part of this community. I'm glad for the friendship and the encouragement that I've received so much of. And yeah, so I just want to take part in that Cal and support that because I think it's a great idea. I think it's really important. So I'm going to get on it and register and enter my little Sabela in that Unity Cal. And I encourage you too, if you don't know about it, it's Cedar Hill Farms. And it just started at the beginning of this year, January 1st. So you can join in and also just to bring unity back where there may have been division or strife or stress because we need that. So I'm working on that last project I'm going to share with you. And I feel kind of like I didn't have very much knitting to share or I haven't made much progress in things over the last few weeks because the holidays were here. I didn't get as much knitting done as I wanted, but it was a good time. It was a good time to just enjoy family and enjoy that way. But I feel like a little bit like I don't have too much knitting to share this time. But this is one that I would like to share. And speaking of that community that I was just talking about, I had shown this sweater that I had gotten and I didn't know the name of it. I didn't know the designer. And Ellen at Senko Farms posted on her Instagram page about the podcast. Thank you so much, Ellen. I'm so grateful to you. And she also mentioned that I was trying to locate the name of this pattern, that I was trying to find the designer and the name of this pattern. And then Molly at Molly O'Malley got in touch with me and told me the name of it. She knew the pattern. And so I was able to go on Ravelry, find it. And now I can tell you and let you know that it is the Garter Stitch Swingy Sweater. I don't have to call it the pattern with no name anymore. It has been identified. And the designer of the pattern is Jenn Pellerin. It's P-E-L-L-E-R-I-N, Jenn Pellerin. So thank you, Ellen, and thank you, Molly, and thank you, Jenn Pellerin, for this beautiful pattern that you put out on Ravelry as a free pattern. It's such a cute little design, and there's also a couple of other pictures on there showing you people who've made it and the different little tweaks and adjustments they've made to it. And so I'm very glad to know that, but that's the community. That's what I'm talking about, that helping each other, helping one another. It's just, there's nothing that's better than that. There's nothing that replaces that. So I like the idea, once again, of that Unity Cal, and I'm going to join it as soon as I can. I have to just get myself together to do that. So here is my Garter Stitch Swingy Sweater. And as I said, I had made the neckline, I think, is a little too big. I think I'm going to redo it somehow. I'm not sure yet, but I haven't done any progress on this one. That's what I was talking about, not getting a lot of knitting done over the past weeks during the holiday time. And so this is how it looks here. It's a little hard to show if I hold it this way. Yeah. It's a very pretty design. It's a very pretty design, but I think my neckline is a little wide. So, and I got so much nice advice about different ways to try to fix that. So I haven't decided yet what I'm going to do. I haven't done anything with this over the holidays. I didn't work on this at all, but I am going to continue with it because I think it's a really pretty pattern. And I think the yarn that I chose, it's a nice thick, kind of a chunky yarn. The colors are just absolutely gorgeous. And I would love to have this finished and be able to wear it. So I'm gonna work on the neckline and see what I need to do to fix that. By James C. Brett. It's called Marble Chunky. James C. Brett. And here I think you can also see the color. It's MC46 is the color. James C. Brett, Marble Chunky. And it is really these beautiful blues and greens, turquoise, how they just kind of flow into one another. It is such a beautiful yarn. I'll show it to you in the ball so you can see it there as well. It is so, so pretty. And these are just the colors that just thrill me. So I'm looking forward to finishing this sweater, or getting it on track with the neckline and then finishing it. Creates kind of a nice thick fabric that I think is going to be just warm and so, so pretty. So I'll just have to keep working on this one. And that is it as far as knitting projects for this episode. But one knitting related thing that I would like to talk about is that I'm really excited about. For Christmas, I received something that was on my list. It's the Tiaogu interchangeable knitting needles. And these are just so, so smart. They're just, I love the interchangeable idea because I was always at the store. I would never have the needle that I needed for the size project. I would start a new project and I didn't have the size. And it comes in this cute little package that's so neat and organized and well thought out. Let me show you all the different needles in here. The needle tips, make sure they don't fall out. And it comes from, I bought the full set. So it has from size 2, US size 2, up to US 15. So pretty much any size that you might want to use comes in here. And they each have their own little slot that they fit in, and it's labeled so you can easily find what you're looking for. I bought the 5-inch tips, by the way. I wasn't sure if I should go for the 4-inch or the 5-inch, but I thought having a little, that extra room might be more comfortable for my hands. So I got the 5-inch tips, and this set comes with 3 cables for the large size needles, 14-inch, 22-inch, and 30-inch cables. And also the same size cables for the small size needles, 14-inch, 22-inch, and 30-inch cables. So I am enjoying it so much. And I didn't show you that they also have this little zipper front, this little zipper in the front. And they come with lots of cute little stitch markers, very pretty, in blue and yellow and green and pink, different size stitch markers, and this little needle, a little ruler, and a gauge. What do you call it? Little gauge marker, and then stoppers so that you can put your work in progress on a cable and leave it there. You can put stoppers on the end of it to keep it there. And then little tightening pins. I don't know if you can see that. The little tightening pins there for tightening the cables. So I am enjoying this. It was one of my favorite Christmas presents for the year. And beautiful bamboo needles in this smooth wood that is, I think it's going to be just really a pleasure to work with. So that is very exciting, my Tiaogu needles. And I'm thinking when my birthday comes up at the end of this month, I might buy myself a few more cables just to have a little bit of different lengths that I'll be able to use. So very, very, very happy about this. Looking forward to using those. And one other idea that I'd like to share with you is this book, Jesus Always. And the subtitle of it is Embracing Joy in His Presence. And this is what I was just talking about before. Embracing Joy in His Presence. And this is by Sarah Young. And she, her first book was Jesus Calling, which I have right here. Here it is, Jesus Calling by Sarah Young. And they come in all different designs and all different styles. She has so many different ones. And it is such a wonderful, wonderful book. It's a devotional book. There are 365 devotions in each book. And this focuses on joy, about finding joy and embracing joy in His presence. So I would recommend this. If you don't know Sarah Young's work, if you never had the Jesus Calling book or any of her other books, I would recommend them. They are so heartwarming. And it's written as though the Lord is speaking directly to you. So when you read it, it's almost like you feel Him speaking or you hear Him speaking to you. It touches your heart in a way that is hard for me to explain. I have enjoyed these books so much. I read Jesus Calling last year. This was my devotional for last year. And now this is the one I just started this year, just a week ago or so. And it has been so wonderful. It focuses on joy. It helps you to find that joy in His presence. And then one thing that I have to say is that before I read any of her books, I would see these Jesus Calling books all over the place, all different styles and designs. Jesus Calling, Jesus Always, Jesus Today, Jesus Calling for Grandmothers, Jesus Calling for this. And I was kind of, you know, I was a little bit like, oh, it's just something that, you know, some money-making thing that is just all this stuff that is, you know, and I would just kind of turn my nose up at it, which is not the right attitude to have about things. And, but then 2 years ago, at the end of 2020, so 1 year ago, at the end of 2020, I saw there was an advertisement that I looked at about Jesus Calling for Christmas. And so I thought, well, I was looking for a Christmas devotional, a special devotional to read at Christmas time. So I'll try it. And so here it is. I got it, Jesus Calling for Christmas. And I began to read it. And the words, and again, it's like the Lord is speaking directly to you. And the beautiful, I'll just show you a couple of the pictures, the beautiful photography, the beautiful pictures that it includes. And the soothing, beautiful words. Let's see, I'll show you another picture. This is another one. And just the beautiful words. It touched my heart. I enjoyed this book so much last Christmas. I mean, so much. I had to almost repent. I was like, Sarah Young, I am so sorry. I was snarky about your books. I love them. I'm so glad I read it. I'm so sorry that I was snooty about, you know, your books and your writing. And I hadn't tried it. And for some reason I was feeling like, oh, because there are so many of them, it's just some, you know, I had to repent. But these books, I enjoyed it so much. It was such a blessing to me last Christmas that after Christmas, when they went on sale, I bought a copy for my mother and all of my sisters for this Christmas, and I saved it. I saved them for the whole year, and then at the end, sometime in November, I sent them out to all of them and said, you have to read this for this year. And so, let me look at this picture, and it has scriptures in it. So beautiful. So I read this again this past Christmas. There are 50 devotionals in it. I think there's 50. Yeah, there's 50 devotionals in it. So I start the last 10 days of November, so a little bit before Thanksgiving, and it carries me all the way through to about the first 10 days of January. So it covers the entire holiday season for Thanksgiving, for Christmas, for New Year. This has been such a blessing to me. So I encourage you, I'm so sorry, Sarah Young, that I was mean about your books. I encourage you to try these. If you haven't, if you don't know the Jesus Calling books, try this. But especially considering joy, check this one out. This is Embracing Joy in His Presence. And I think, I can't tell you how heartwarming it is. It is so good. And her writing is just so tender and sweet. And it's based on scripture. And it has, at the end of the devotional, it has the scripture that she's using in the devotional. And it shows you, and it has the scripture that the devotional is based on at the bottom. And some of them just have some, I know some of the copies, some of the editions just have the references printed out, but then you can get ones. And I like to have the ones where they actually print out the entire verse, not just the reference. So this would be a wonderful one. If you're thinking about joy and you want to have more joy, this would be a wonderful, or any of her books, really, any of her books would be wonderful to read. And especially a devotional that kind of takes you through the whole year a little bit to focus your heart on joy every morning. That's one of the first things I do in the morning is I get up and I read my devotional. I read my Bible. I do my Psalms. I'm doing my wintering in the Psalms right now, where I read the Psalms and I write out insights and ideas from the Psalms. And then I get my Jesus always. And right now, over this past few weeks, I've added in my Jesus Calling for Christmas. So that's my devotional time. So I encourage you to look, check out her books. They are wonderful. And one last thing I would mention or recommend to you is if you don't know about the TV series called The Chosen, it is the life of Christ done as a TV series. There's they've just finished the first two seasons. There's season one has 8 episodes and season two has, I think, 8 episodes. And I believe season 3 will be coming out sometime this spring. I'm not sure, but it is so good. It is so well done. You will enjoy it. I didn't know about it they've done 2 seasons and I just heard about it a few weeks ago and I was so anxious to start watching it. My husband and I have been watching it and it is so good. It's very, very popular. They have a YouTube channel called The Chosen, the YouTube channel, where you can see behind the scenes footage. They do interviews with the stars of the TV show and the guy that plays Jesus is so good. He is just the best Jesus that I've seen on film or television. It is just such a wonderful show. They can go, because they're doing it over 7 seasons, they can really get into the characters of all the disciples. And it just shows Jesus in such a human way. You see him as, you know, sometimes if you look at the paintings that they do of Jesus or some of the teachings about Jesus, it seems like he's always just kind of solemn and a little bit sad and not somebody that you want to really hang out with. But this show shows him in such a human way. And this guy just portrays so much compassion and so much tenderness. And when he hugs people, it's just like you just want to melt. It is so well done. It's so good. I really encourage you, if you get a chance. I mean, you can go through YouTube, find the Chosen channel on YouTube. All the episodes are there. It's completely free. That's another thing I didn't mention, but it's completely free. It's like a television show, except it's not produced by any of the big TV networks. It's an independent project that they're doing, and it's completely free. You can find it the first 2 seasons so far on YouTube, or they also have a website. It's thechosentv.com, I think. If you put in thechosentv.com, you can find all the episodes there as well and watch there. But it is so good. It's so well done. We're just enjoying it so much. So I wanted to let you know about that in case you didn't know. I think that's everything. I'll have to see, because this kind of feels like it was a long episode, but I'll have to see. But as always, I just want to say thank you. Thank you so much for watching. Thank you for commenting and sending in advice and encouragement. I really appreciate it. And thank you that the channel is growing. Those of you, again, who have recommended it and who are, you know, sharing it with others, I'm so grateful. Thank you so much. And as always, before we go, I'd like to pray for you. So, Father, thank you. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness. I am just so overwhelmed and amazed by you, Father. Thank you for all that you've done. Thank you that you're working in every situation. Father, we pray your blessing. I pray your blessing over those who are watching. I pray that you would help them to find the joy that is so important. Lord Jesus, you prayed for us to have joy. And I know that is a prayer that was answered. That is a prayer that was heard and answered. So the joy is there. It's available to us. So give us the grace, give us the wisdom, Lord, to choose it, to seek you for it, to spend that time in your presence so that you can fill our hearts with joy, so that we shout for joy, we jump for joy. All the things from all the scriptures that I read, Lord. So thank you. Thank you once again. I pray that you would give peace, that you would give joy, you would give wisdom, Lord. And as we look forward to this new year, we don't know what the future holds, Lord, but we know that you do. You hold the future. So we trust you. Help us to trust you more as we go through this year. Father, help us to keep our eyes on you. Help us to keep our eyes on you and to just walk the path that you're laying out before us. I pray your blessing over all my friends here in this channel, Lord. Thank you for the goodness. Thank you for your mercy. We are so grateful to you. We give all praise, all honor, all glory to your name. We pray these things and we thank you for these things. In Jesus' name, amen. So friends, thank you so much once again. I pray a great next couple of weeks for you until I see you again. God bless you. Choose joy. Show him to the world. Thanks so much. Bye-bye.
Oh.